dry bulk freight market has come out of the turmoil it had been in the past. For close to 2 years, the market has been traversing on a fairly steady plank. We have been witnessing stronger seaborne trade growth, while the threat of a full-blown trade war is glaring at us. Often considered the workhorse of the dry bulk market, the Supramax segment has remained as resilient as ever, with freight rates on the vessels staying at healthy levels. To get some insights on the Supramax market, as well as on the freight pricing dynamics, we have with us Punit Oza, Vice President and Head of Asia Pacific Supramax Market at Klaveness Asia. Punit, thanks for joining us today. So to start off, could you give us a sense of idea as to what direction the global dry bulk market is moving in the short to medium term, especially the Supramax segment?
Yeah, I think the dry bulk market has actually been enjoying some pretty good gains. Historically, you have to put this in perspective. The market has actually been skewed a little bit by the exorbitantly crazy rates which were there in 2003 to 2008. But if you take away those periods, the market has actually been at a historically fairly good levels in the last few months. The supply side has eased off a lot because the new buildings have actually trickled to a much lower level and historically low levels. And the demand centers have actually shifted mostly to Asia, which has powered a tremendous amount of value in terms of long hauls, for example, because of the imports from the Atlantic into the Pacific. India has been growing at a steady pace, which has also been a good powerhouse. But also the other markets in general have actually been quite growing at a good pace in Southeast Asia. We see in Supramax segment, there is a transition, right? So normally when you actually start with a new market, Supramaxes are kind of the first people to hit that market because of the fact that they are geared grabbed vessels, and you need to have the geared grabbed vessels to lighten, unload or load the cargoes because the port facilities are not yet developed. So Vietnam, Thailand, Malaysia, Philippines, they've all basically been starting off with that. And they've been growing with the Supras being a major part of their chunk. Overall, we see that the trade war aspect, as you mentioned, clearly is definitely weighing on people's mind. But having said that, when it comes to the market and the seasonality part of it, the Supramax market has been quite resilient. And the resilience has also partly been because the intra-Asia trade flows have been extremely vital in keeping this market going. Yeah. And if you combine that with some of the long hauls or both back and front haul, I think the market has been at a fairly steady clip. And I think that will continue, especially with the coming regulations of IMO 2020, which I'm sure we'll talk more about.
So it's pretty much good going for the Supramax market at the moment. But coming to the specificity of the freight pricing indices, so what's your view of adopting time charter equivalent or TCE pricing in freight contracts?
I think that's a very good idea because traditionally the normal time charter rate providers or the indices providers, and there are a few around now, there was a monopoly of one, but there was more who have come in the market now. They all are basically looking at a TCE or time charter number, which is basically being fixed in the market. And I still believe that the time charter has its own challenges. First of all, most of the time charter numbers are being reported by brokers, and they are basically very difficult to break down to a kind of a standard denomination. Every vessel is being fixed for a different reason or different area. So even in Southeast Asia, as an example, if your vessel is open in Philippines or Singapore versus being open in South China, if you're loading an Indonesia cargo, your ballast can easily be different by something like 2 to 3 days. And that's like 10% of the voyage duration if you're looking at a 30-day duration. But they are reported as time charters at $14,000, so that's what people talk about. The market is $14,000. The TCE is basically, as you mentioned, a way of distilling a standard voyage cargo, a freight rate which is fixed, back using a standard calculation into a time charter equivalent, which is what every operator and owner also does at the end of the day. His real realization on a voyage cargo is essentially the TCE. And that's actually a much more easier way because you're actually comparing apples and apples. I also believe that in time charters, you have other considerations into account, whether you know the positioning is involved. There is also a cash flow element involved in terms of how people manage their cash flows by doing time charters. There's a whole bunch of things which actually contribute to the time charter level, but TCE is a far more transparent way of looking at it. So I still believe that if a TCE is actually distilled in the correct and standard and transparent manner, it is probably a much better way of benchmarking the actual freight rates being fixed rather than the actual TCE levels. So I'm very much in favor of
that. That's a very interesting take from you, Punit. But staying on TCE, We are seeing a market where a sizable number of Supramax and handy-sized vessels that rarely ballast from the Asia-Pacific into the Atlantic. And what they try to do is they try to triangulate within the region. So a lot of these vessels also belong to small and medium-sized ship owners. Do they have an option to hedge their positions? Will a weighted average TCE index covering the Asia-Pacific market alone be of any help?
Yeah, there have been talks about it, and there have also been other index providers who have actually started looking at Pacific indices, and it has actually been a mixed success. One of the reasons for that, again, as I mentioned, is those are based on time charter rates, and the time charter rates are, again, the source is multiple broking sources, which don't have really the deal flow in the real sense of the word. But I still believe that having a Pacific index and ability to trade it liquidly is probably very vital. As you mentioned, there are lots of these owners who like to remain in the Pacific. I would say the range on the Supermaxes is between Persian Gulf and Japan, so PG Japan range, as they call it. And I think it's very valid that those owners also need to cover them in some form or the other. The market is fairly spot. They like to keep themselves in this region for various reasons. But they are also having this window of 25 to 30 days. And if the seasonality and the volatility is so much that they are not able to get the right timing and the right position on those ships, they are not able to then use the best value on those Pacific routes. So a weighted average or average of the Pacific routes is quite interesting. Also, interestingly, some of the routes that are actually prevalent today where the activity has picked up, a lot of the index providers have not been able to inculcate those routes into the index as well because of the fact that it's a process. So the key is to be able to be agile and to be able to do a quick assimilation or integration of some of the new routes which are coming up. For example, the route from Middle East into India has primarily come up in the last 1 year on back of heavy steel demand or steel production in India. Now, the limestone business was never there on the Supramaxes in that volume. But today, you don't have a route that represents it in some of the other index providers. So definitely something, there's a value that if a person who's trading in the PG India region and is trading in the Pacific would like to assimilate or include that route because that's an integral part of his trading pattern. So I think there is a value in that sense, but that value has to integrate all the current routes which are active and which are actually having volume. So it needs to be a fair representation of the market.
Sure. So in essence, it has to capture the entire region where you have the most of the liquidity happening. Okay, that's a very interesting take. But as a ship owner come operator, you have a very wide view of the market since you're able to don the hat of an owner, an operator, and a charterer. And given the broad perspective that you would have, what do you think are the advantage of TCE, time charter equivalent, compared to just time charter rates?
So I'll give you an Indo to India example that you probably take a vessel on at, say, $12,000 a day. And if you take a vessel on at $12,000 a day, you're only paying the first 15 days of hire. Maybe you don't even have to pay bunkers because if you have actually going to bunker the vessel in Singapore, you don't pay for the value of the bunkers and delivery. You pay $10,000, $15,000 for your port cost. And then after a span of, say, 10 to 15 days, when you finish loading of the cargo, you get a massive chunk of, say, a $12, $13, $14 freight rate on a 55,000 tons of cargo. The TCE is a very pure and honest way of representing what the market levels are. So I think TCE is basically distilling and taking away all the noise, so as to speak, and clarifying what the actual rates are. They're also a lot more real and real time because most of the time when you talk about voyage cargoes, those are what's being done in the real market sense. I still believe that the traditional ship owners were all voyage chartering people. They always wanted to do voyage cargoes because it gives you a feel of the real market. If you look at time charters, at the end of the day, it's purely an investment. Right? If you are an owner, you're giving away your ship on time charter, you're not really a ship owner, you're an investor.
It's like a fixed deposit.
Exactly. So the TCE, therefore, has a more real feel of the market than TC as such. And that is something which is very relevant to how businesses are done, especially in a liquid market. If a market is liquid, you have a route where continuous businesses are being done, then your ability to discover a real price is actually purely a TCE. Rather than TC.
Do you think the habits are changing in the market for the market to embrace TCE?
I think the habits will change as the market gets more spot. If you have a longer term contract market, you automatically are bound to have more period charters and TC charters getting into it because there is an opportunity to lock in certain revenue flows against your time chartered vessels. Yeah. Supramax market has become so spot, especially in the Pacific, where you actually are finding that the value of having TCE is far more than TC, purely because it's a spot market. And for spot market, you need price discovery to happen on a daily basis. So I think habits are changing, but again, shipping is notoriously known to actually be very slow in reacting to changes. So we just have to bear with it and educate the people as best as we can. And of course, if they find relevance in it, I think also it's a bit of a herd mentality, because you find some of the big players coming into the arena, you will automatically find the smaller players coming a little bit into it as well. So I think it's really a question of how you can time it.
Okay, that sounds encouraging for us at Platts at least.
Yes.
Okay, then the last question is, with the kicking in of the IMO 2020 regulations, 1st of Jan of the year, what do you think would be the changes that will augur on the freight pricing mechanism or the methodologies, you know?
I think the IMO 2020 is, first of all, a real thing. The challenge, of course, is that a lot of people have been falsely buoyed by the fact that the last regulation was deferred and postponed, the ballast water treatment one. So they still believe that there's a chance that this one gets delayed as well. I don't think it will. At least that's the view from us and Klaveness as well, that it is something which is there. Secondly, the actual awareness of this is very little. Not only the awareness is little, we also believe the pricing of the forward markets has still not factored in the changes that we expect to see. The oil companies have been very, very cagey in terms of holding most of the cards to the chest. Mm-hmm. They've not told us what kind of compliant fuel, what kind of pricing will you have. Mm-hmm. But if they don't come up with a pricing or a compliant fuel for initial period of time, you have to have no option but to use gas oil and diesel oil. And effectively what that means is that you are going to increase the cost of your transportation, whether you like it or not. But what is unknown and what is not yet known in a big way is how will IMO regulation be implemented? Because the implementation of the regulations and the penalty regime has left by IMO to the individual maritime states. So the proposed penalties for breach of this regulation in Singapore is Singapore dollars $10,000 per breach, which is a very, very small amount. At the same time, if you're in Norway, the penalties for the breach are unlimited. The flag state can charge whatever they feel is deemed as a penalty. America, for example, is proposing a penalty of $25,000 per day from the date of the breach, even if the vessel was not in American waters at the time of breach. So a retroactive or retrospective penalty, which is quite challenging. And of course, penalties, if you're falsifying your oil record books, you have a 6-year imprisonment in federal law. So it's not very easy to try and predict where these penalty regimes are going to land. What that will do is essentially that will create a two-tier market. First of all, the fuel-efficient vessels will actually get a lot more value, purely because of the cost of the fuel going up.
Yeah.
And the second part is, where are you trading your ship? Which brings me back to the initial point that we had about this weighted Pacific trade or weighted Pacific index, which will become very relevant for an owner who basically believes, because of this penalty regime, his trading pattern is going to get even more constricted to Pacific areas, and he needs to be able to actually find a basket where he can hedge his positions in a much more kind of efficient manner. And today, that is probably not available to him as easily as possible. So hopefully, the basket of weighted average Pacific routes will probably bring a lot of value, especially with the IMO 2020.
Absolutely. When you're talking about premium, do you think it makes sense for prices to be published for scrubber vessels versus non-scrubber vessels? I mean, to say a TCE rates for vessels with scrubber and a TCE rate for vessels without scrubber.
I think on the bigger sizes, it does make sense. And I think there is already a discussion, I'm sure, with the counterparties talking about the fact that, okay, we are looking at the next contract and we would like to have rates with and without scrubber. Because the only challenge there is that if the charterer, and our experience is, the charterer actually asks for a multiple rate like that, he is already inviting from the owner a question saying, if you want a dual rate, would you be able to contribute to the cost of the scrubber? So you have to take into consideration that that is going to happen. But when you do put those two rates, if you do decide to do that for the bigger sizes, for example, you have to put a caveat saying that this is subject to what kind of commercial deals can actually happen between the parties. And maybe the charterers would be actually asked to contribute to the value of the scrubber. because at $2 million, it's still a lot of money being put in there.
Absolutely. There's a lot of money, and we will see a lot more changes happening as we get closer to IMO 20. So thanks, Punit, for your insight. It was a pleasure having you on the show. Thanks for watching.